سلام علیکم و رحمت الله. بسم الله الرحمن الرحیم. All praises are Allah's, Lord of the worlds, and may His peace and blessings be upon our Master, the Holy Prophet Muhammad, and His pure Immaculate Ahlul Bayt. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. I would like to first say it's an honor to share this night with you, brothers and sisters. Thank you for inviting me here. And although the introduction was a bit of an exaggeration, I'm not a world-renowned speaker. This is only my second time I'm speaking in the UK. But yes, they gave me a title to speak about and speak a few words on in relation to building a vibrant community. And I won't be able to cover this in detail, so only one or two ideas I want to share with you. I'm not saying it's 100% correct or anything. It's worthy to think about. Notable scholars have mentioned these ideas, which I want to share with you. And then towards the second half of the lecture, it's a tradition from the Holy Messenger, where that tradition I want to read, where 30 instructions are given on how the mu'mineen and the Muslims in general have to behave with one another. But before that, just a small introduction. Ayatollah Hassanzade Amuli, who's one of the leading scholars in Irfan today in Iran, he's written that a community without Irfan is like a lifeless corpse. Now, this is something very important. A community without Irfan, now this is not the theoretical Irfan necessarily that they study in the seminaries. It's practical Irfan, basic Irfan that even children can learn. A community without Irfan is like a lifeless corpse. There's no growth. And I want to just open this up a bit, and then we'll go to the prophetic tradition, inshallah. In relation to the verses of the Holy Quran, the traditions of the Ahlul Bayt, in relation to our aqa'id, our doctrine, in relation to our supplications, the du'as that we have, and in relation to our ahkam, the Islamic rulings that we have, all these things, there are two dimensions associated with them. And both are necessary. And sufficing with one of them, either one, sufficing with it will lead to problems in a community. Islam is a multidimensional religion. You can't just take one part of it and reject the other dimensions. It's a package, if you like. One has to benefit from this package multidimensionally. But if one confines one's benefit of the Quran and of Islam in general to one dimension, and sufficing with that one dimension, and rejecting or being ignorant towards or being oblivious towards the other dimensions, that's going to cause problems. So these things, they all have an external dimension, and no one rejects that. The verses of the Quran, the traditions of the Ahlul Bayt, the du'as, the Islamic rulings, the halals and the harams, the aqa'id, they all have this external dimension. It's important. It's a first step. They all have a superficial meaning or a prima facie meaning. They all have it. And we have to grasp onto it and benefit from it. And we should never negate that superficial dimension of it. We shouldn't go against it. But that's only the superficial dimension. It's step one. It's important. The problems arise when we limit ourselves and limit the community. We limit it. We confine Islam to this superficial dimension. Problems may arise. You can't limit Islam, the Quran, Allah's knowledge, which is infinite, from pre-eternity to post-eternity. You can't limit it to the superficial dimension. If we do limit Islam to the superficial dimension, don't get me wrong, the superficial, the external dimension is step one. It's the most important step. Without it, you can't go to step two. I don't want no one to misunderstand. The Sharia is important. The external dimension is important. But when you say it's the letter of the law, Islam equals the letter of the law, full stop, and you suffice with the letter of the law, and that's it, that's Islam, that's going to cause problems. Not only are you limiting Islam, and I'll give you a few traditions soon, not only are you limiting Islam, but you're wasting and limiting yourself. And as a result, the community will suffer to such an extent that Ayatollah Hassan Zadeh says, a community without Irfan is like a lifeless corpse. There's no growth. They may give you heaven. It's okay. Many animals will go to heaven. It's going to be very basic, a very minimum heaven that you're going to be given, though. Heaven has degrees. Your potential is infinite. If you just suffice with this superficial understanding, you're limiting the self. Now, this I will try to explain this more as we go through this. However, then, there's an esoteric, inner, spiritual dimension to the verses of the Quran, the traditions of the Ahlul Bayt, to the du'as, to the aqa'id that we have, and even to the halal and harams that we have. Even these very halal and harams that we have, the letter of the law, this very letter of the law has a lot of inner dimensions. And this has to be introduced, especially to the youth. Here, it's an inner dimension now. There's nothing outside you. As they say, it's an anfusi dimension. It's soul-orientated. It's soul-based. It's a dimension that has to be incorporated within the soul. Now here, there's no limit. There's no limit to the inner dimensions of religion. There's no end. In the Sharia, yes, there's a beginning and there's an end. We have Sunnis, we have Shias. According to certain criteria, the Sharia has that. Aqa'id has that. Depending on your Sharia aqa'id, we introduce terms like Sunni and Shiism. That's the Sharia. In spirituality, the terms Sunnism and Shiism don't apply like they do in the Sharia, in the letter of the law, like they do in theology. It's a different realm now. This inner aspect of religion is important. And it's this inner aspect of religion which you can even teach to your children at a young age. But you have to do it in a careful manner. I know Irfan has been abused throughout the centuries, especially in the East, and people have this negative connotation, rightfully, in relation to the words like Sufism or Irfan, the tariqas, but all these are realities. Just because it's been abused, It doesn't mean they don't exist. Now, one or two traditions from the Ahlul Bayt. Imam Sadiq alayhi salam has said, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad wa ajjan faja. Inna lil Qur'an dhahran wa batna. The Qur'an has a superficial aspect and it has an inner aspect. Wa li batnihi batna. And that inner aspect of it also has an inner, another inner dimension to it. Elo sab'ati abton. And go seven times over. Each inner dimension, within it there's an inner dimension. Within it, that inner dimension, there's another inner dimension. Keep on going seven times. In some traditions it says 700 times. In some 7,000 times. Meaning there's no end. There's no end because the Qur'an is Allah's knowledge being manifested. But it's manifested for our benefit to a very minimum Arabic script. And then we have to understand this superficial meaning and then grow within it to understand the inner dimensions of it. Another tradition, he says, Al-Qur'anu taqri'un kullu. The Qur'an is always on the attack. It has an attacking nature, all of it. Wa batinuhu, but its inner dimension, taqribun. It brings you closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's about proximity. See, again, the two dimensions. One dimension, the verses of the Quran, gives X sentence, Y sentence to this criminal, to that criminal. It gives a lot of prohibitions and so on and so forth. But the same prohibitions, its esoteric dimensions, it's all about getting closer to Allah. I just want you to appreciate that there are levels to religion. Don't think there's only one level, and that's the letter of the law, and that's it. It's a very deep religion, Islam. So, the verses of the Quran, the du'as, aqa'id, the ahkam, everything, they all have these inner realities. Aside from the, in addition to the external realities that is the superficial aspect, there are inner realities here at stake. The external side is what you see. For example, you see the how to do the wudu, how to do the ghusl. You see the ruku, the sajda. These are all the external aspects of the salat, for example. And they have to be abided by. There's no question about it. You can't compromise with the Sharia, with the letter of the law. It's step one. However, if you just do the external actions without appreciating the inner etiquettes, the inner meanings of those external actions, lifeless corpse. It's just physical actions with no meaning. And this can be problematic, especially for the youth. I'll just give one example. All our lives we do the wudu, for example. And all we benefit from the wudu is the letter of the law in relation to the wudu. It's two washings and two wipings, and the washings is, you know, from here. We teach our children exactly from where to where. And we teach the wudu solely confining it to this physical washing. That's it. With no inner meaning whatsoever. The same with all aspects of Islamic rituals. Even in aqa'id, but in this example it's to do with ahkam. And when you limit the wudu only to this physical sequence of actions, then the youth, they come up with a question. They say, well, I've just had a shower, there's no need to do the wudu anymore. Then how are the parents, how are the grandparents going to answer now? Because when you just limit the wudu to this physical action, never explaining the inner meanings to it, this child will have this legitimate question, and they're right. The wudu you've explained to them, it's irfanless. It's only a few physical actions that you do, and you usually tell them it's out of cleanliness. Most of you came from Africa or Asia. You were taught religion in a particular way in school and back home. And religion was taught in a very particular way, and you accepted whatever you were told. It wasn't really an evaluation that you were offered, or even you weren't even taught how to evaluate things. And it's okay. I'm not saying it's wrong or anything, but it's a certain approach that most people had in the East. Then destiny brought you here, and now you have children here. Then you take your children out to British schools and everything. And there they're taught to question everything, to criticize everything, to evaluate everything, not to accept anything before they accept it, you know, rationality-wise. Now they're questioning everything. You didn't have that. The children do have that. The youth have it. And Islam, which is confined to one dimension alone, can't offer results to the youth. You can't bring them on board. You can't attract Islam for them. That unidimensional Islam that many people in the East are used to, and they're very good people, they may be better than us. It's the approach I'm questioning here. I'm not saying some people are better or worse than others. I'm just saying there's a difference of approach. We're going to sacrifice many generations if we don't be careful. Now you've come here, at least try and incorporate other dimensions of Islam. Otherwise, the youth will just disappear from you. Islam has layers. There are layers to Islam. You were taught a certain way, and that's okay. But that way may not offer results to the youth. Ash-shari'atu aqwali, the Holy Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad wa jalla. The Sharia is my words. At-tariqatu af'ali. But the tariqa, they're my actions. I'll explain those actions in a minute. Wal-haqiqatu ahwali. And the haqiqa, the truth, the objective of religion, the end game, the end goal, is my states, the states of the Holy Prophet. What he saw, what he heard, we have that potential. Allama Tabatabai said, that's the goal, that's the haqiqa. But the way to the haqiqa is the tariqa. The way to the tariqa is the sharia. It starts with the sharia. The tariqa, though, they're the noble ethical traits. These three, it's one reality, different dimensions. With the tariqa, it's outside the jurisdiction of the sharia. Not to do with wajibs and harams anymore. But it's to do with more important metaphysical truths. That if you neglect, you've lost the battle. If you neglect the noble ethical traits, the makarim al-akhlaq, the tariqa that Islam has. Now the sharia is one. And we follow the marija, and there's no question there. The marija, like in the same way that if you have, let's say, cancer, and the cancer is a specific form of cancer, you don't go to any doctor. If you have a cold, it doesn't matter which doctor you go to. They'll all give you the same thing. In Marja'iyya too. If you want to have a question in Salat, then they're all going to say the same thing. It doesn't matter. But there are differences between them. You go to the most learned. You do your research. And whoever it is, you stick with them. It doesn't matter what others say. You stick with yours. Let's not make this Marja'iyya a big problem in the community. You go to the specialist in cancer, you do your research, they say these three are the best in the world with in relation to your cancer, you choose one of them. The same thing happens in the tariqah. The same things happen here. A marja is a marja in one's sharia, in one's halals and harams. If you become a mujtahid yourself and you become your own marja, it's okay, there's no problem. But if you don't, or if you don't become a doctor, you follow the doctor, you follow the expert. But someone who's a marja in fiqhi issues, they don't become a marja by default in tariqa issues. Think about that a bit. One may be an expert in fiqh and usul, but they may not be a mujtahid in ethics, in irfan, in philosophy, in tafsir, in aqa'id. No, there's no guarantee. There have been marajis in history who were mujtahids in 5 or 6, in addition to fiqh and usul, they were mujtahids in ethics, akhlaq, in irfan, in tafsir. In their 20s, they were mujtahids. And in our time, the late Imam Khomeini was one of those. He was a mujtahid in his 20s before marrying in 6 or 7 fields. In the same way we follow a marja in Sharia, we have to follow a marja also in the tariqa. However, since the tariqa has been abused a lot, the scholars have said it's out of the best interests of the common lay people. Let's not bring this marjaiyat system in the tariqa. It's not wajib after all. A lot of abuse has been done in the last few centuries. And since it's not one of the wajibat in the canonical sense, they haven't really put it forward. And that's their decision, and we respect that. But the tariq is important. You can't limit Islam to the sharia. You can't just limit it to the superficial aspect. We have to understand the inner meanings. The inner meanings of the Sharia, we want to know. An irfan-less community, lifeless corpse. So, in the Sharia, it speaks of water. Then it says, look, we have many kinds of water. We have qalil water, and we have kur water. Qalil is little water, of a very small volume, or not very small, but it's less than kor. Kor is X hundreds of liters, for example, volume-wise. Let's say 400 liters. Is that it? We just have water. One is, let's say, qalil, little. One is voluminous, a lot. And then we're told to cleanse our bodies or our clothes or other things from these najasat, these impure things. See, if you just limit it to that, it's okay, and it's important to know. But it's important to know there are some inner meanings to water. Water has esoteric meanings to it. Qalil, little water, has meanings attached to it. Core water has inner meanings attached to it. And all these superficial physical things are meant to be conduits, routes to metaphysical realities. And that's why the Sharia, we have to start with the Sharia. We have to start with the tangible. And from this tangible, we transcend to the metaphysical meanings. But if we never become attentive to the metaphysical meanings, we're just stuck with the tangible. Just with water. Little water, a lot of water. And then people get obsessed. They acquire waswas. Because they're just drowned in this superficial aspect. This very water existence has many dimensions to it. This is the physical dimension of existence here. All other realms of existence, it's metaphysical. Only the dunya here is physical. This water that we have, its reality is knowledge. According to the logic of the Quran, logic of the traditions of the Ahlul Bayt, water is knowledge, it's ma'rifah, it's gnosis. Gnosis to become purified. You, the self, it's all now within now. See, now we're going to the metaphysical. It's now all soul-based. Water. The Sharia speaks of water. We just look at the physical water, the physical wudu, from X to Y, that's it, for 70 years, 80, 100 years, never paying attention to the inner meanings. Water is ma'rifah. Yes, you use qalil water or kor water as prescribed in the Sharia. As you're using it, try to be attentive to the esoteric dimensions of water. It's ma'rifah. And it's ma'rifah which has to cleanse your soul. Then it says we have two forms of water, two forms of ma'rifah. There's the qalil ma'rifah, little, a bit of knowledge, a bit of ma'rifah. Then we have core water, voluminous water. Let's see. I can't remember how much it was, the exact amount of core above, but whatever it was, voluminous water. Voluminous knowledge, voluminous ma'rifah, two forms of water, two forms of ma'rifah. But what are these? What's ma'rifah to do? Is to cleanse the contaminations that you've acquired in this dunya. Now you're just limiting it to the physical contamination. It's okay. You start with the physical, but this is meant to be a conduit, a route to you being attentive to ma'rifah, which cleanses those impurities within. If the impurity is within the soul, it's little, you can use qalil water. Little knowledge will do. Knowledge, there are levels to knowledge. Sometimes you're so deeply immersed in spiritual contaminations, you need core water, a lot of ma'rifah. You can't mess around with those contaminations. Then those contaminations, if it's very heavy and you use qalil water, that little knowledge in relation to heavy spiritual contaminations, you're going to pollute the whole water. You have to use core water. And then suddenly we have something, another classification of water, mutlaq and mudaf water. Where mutlaq is water, whatever the common lay person regards as water, they call it absolute water, but what they mean, it qualifies as water when the common lay person sees it. Like the water in oceans, for example, or lakes or other. But then we have mudaf water, like the juice of fruits. You don't call the juice of fruits water. You call it orange juice. The common layperson on seeing that won't say that's H2O. Won't say that's water, no. Be careful, your ma'rifah, water, remains always as water and doesn't become mudaf when it blends where it shouldn't blend. You see, the whole picture changes now. The whole outlook of religion changes. You have to look at these inner meanings. Or, for example, the traveler's salat. When the traveler travels, the salat becomes two units. all the four unit prayers become two unit prayers. And the three unit prayer remains as three units. Why? Sometimes I've heard, not here in England, elsewhere, some people don't accept this. Said, no, well, even if I travel, I want to do four units. I have to explain the wisdoms that the scholars have suggested that may be wisdoms behind these rulings. Why should, when you travel, suddenly salat becomes a four-unit salat, becomes two units? What's the wisdom behind that? And they say, when you travel from, let's say, Manchester to Birmingham, and the Sharia has specified after how many kilometers it qualifies as a travel, but when you do make a journey, at night, during the day, throughout many weathers, different climates, in this journey, you're coming out of the norm as you do travel in your hometown. And with the different climates and the weather and, you know, being in a car, going, in those days there were no car, but anything can happen, you recall Allah more. That's why we have many du'as for traveling. You recall Allah more because there are more threats facing you when you travel. It's not like when you travel in your hometown anymore. You're covering a distance. You're covering many different climates, weathers. You're not very prepared. You don't know. It's very unexpected. You recall Allah more. And because of that recalling Allah more, then Allah says, now here, the four unit prayers, you can do two units because you've recalled me a lot. Do two units of prayers for the four units. You've compensated for that. But then the Sharia says, if your intention of traveling is to do sin, is to do something haram, no. Your four units remain four units because there was no Allah in your journey. See how things change now. The outlook changes. Your whole perspective of religion. Now, if you just limit it to a few figures, a few external actions with water, how are we going to grow? There's no growth in these, especially for the youth. Now, this, I've just given a few examples in relation to the Sharia. The same applies in Aqa'id. There's not one way of understanding Tawheed. There's not one way of understanding prophethood. There's not only one understanding of Ma'ad. Yes, the Sharia says if you say there are two Allahs, it's a sin. We all accept Allah is one. But this oneness of Allah is explained differently. What is the essence of a prophet? It's explained differently. Heaven and hell, it's explained differently. But everyone believes in it. You see, I deny heaven or hell, it's haram. Everyone believes in heaven and hell, but there's not one understanding of it. But I mean, if I want to give examples, I don't want to diverge too much. But so we have to look at these inner dimensions, and we have to treat the Sharia as a conduit to those inner metaphysical realities. And you do wudu every day, you do salat every day, with those inner meanings in mind, it's a different ballgame now. There's growth. There has to be growth with it. If you do these rituals with those inner meanings, now, I'm not very familiar with this community. It's the first time I'm here. But I'm sure you have scholars here that they can teach you, especially to the children. Maybe for parents and grandparents, no. They're used to a form of the way they were taught back home, and that's enough for them. We don't want to force people to learn this. But in relation to the youth, it's worthwhile maybe. And there are many good books. Imam Khomeini's Adab al-Salat, it's a milestone book. It goes through all the inner meanings of all components of the Salat and the Wudu and the Ghusl. What does Ghusl mean? What does Janaba mean? What does menstruation mean? We just limit it to a physical dimension. Look how the Urafa explain it. But when you go to the inner meanings, then even a man can become ha'id. You know, it's a spiritual realm now. You have to see what the essence of haze is. And it can apply to men too, on a spiritual realm. But if you just limit it to the physical reality, no. You're just going to get drowned in a few physical things and totally oblivious to the inner realities. Okay. Or for example, someone in a garage or other professions, they have a bit of oil on their hands, for example, or on their nails. And okay, it's an impediment to water reaching the hands or nails. And they come to me, they go to 10 other people saying, what do we do? Is this enough? Is this not enough? And then they acquire vaswas. It's important. There should be no impediment. But if your heart is contaminated with ma'arifa, proof, shield, that don't allow you, because of the sins that you keep on doing, don't even allow you to be susceptible to ma'arifa, and then all your struggle in life is has this gone or not? Totally lost the real picture, and you've limited yourself to this physical aspect, which is important, but you've exaggerated the importance out of bounds. You've acquired obsession, and you've become totally oblivious to the inner meanings of religion. Some people think that if they just do all the wajibat, they refrain from the muharramat, that's it. They're very far away from the truth. There's much more to religion. Yes, that's step one. And yes, you'll be given heaven. But it's, as one scholar said in Rome, they're just giving you your heavenly stable in heaven. It's a minimum. You're just looking for the houris, the palaces, this, that, and they'll give it to you, don't worry. Is that it? Is heaven that? This infinite message that Islam has, infinite levels of spirituality, of closeness to Allah, and that's it? We just suffice with the minimum? If you suffice with the Sharia, if you suffice with it, Imam Khomeini, in one of his works, he said, those who suffice with the Sharia, and say that outside the letter of the law, there's nothing else. He said, these people are the shayateen on the path to Allah. But if you suffice with the Sharia, if you don't be careful, and you think this is Islam, period, it can lead to a lot of side effects. You can become very complacent. You can become very arrogant. Some people, they just know a few rituals. They don't know the inner meanings. All they do is criticize people. In the worst possible way, they criticize. You can't bring people to Islam with this kind of behavior. Many people do all the wajibat, they refrain from the muharramat, but the ethics, it's poor. Poor ethics, poor. Jealousy is not haram. Holding on to grudges isn't haram. Not forgiving people, they're not haram. But these are outside the jurisdiction of the Sharia. These are the noble ethical traits. These have to be acquired. You can't suffice with the letter of the law. You won't grow like that. but with the inner meanings of the Quran, after mastering the superficial aspect of the letter of the law, with the inner meanings of the law, the inner meanings of the Sharia, yes, you'll grow. You'll begin to see. It's all about seeing what the Holy Prophet saw, hearing what he saw. أَإِنْدَهُ إِلْمُ الْغَيْبِ فَهُوَ يَرَى. Does one have knowledge of the unseen? For them to qualify as a seer, but not the seeing that animals do. Seeing beyond the physical. Now, I don't want you to panic. Some people see little, some people more, but that's the goal. Once you start seeing, the self changes. But if it's only a physical seeing, like animals do, no. Imam Khomeini in Adab al-Salat, he writes this. He says, the inner impurities. It's a very important statement. The audacity, I've never seen a scholar have the audacity to put it in this way. And the conclusions are incredible from this statement. No one can be complacent. The inner impurities, lead to the suppression and inhibition of sa'ada, of happiness, salvation. Inner impurities, not only things which are haram according to the Sharia, also things which are haram according to the tariqah. Like not forgiving, holding on to grudges. Respecting your parents according to the Sharia is one way. You can't do anything which in that society that you're living in, if you do that action to your parents, it's expected to lead to their disappointment or anger. So if you shout at them, or if you do other actions, that is expected to lead to their disappointment or anger. That's haram according to the Sharia. Maybe for many of you back home, even putting your feet, laying your feet in front of your parents, that would be expected to lead to the disappointment in that culture. To see which culture we're in. But if you do something which is expected to lead, according to the common layperson of your culture, that leads to their disappointment or anger, that's haram, according to the Sharia. Now here, for example, in England, if someone wants to study, let's say, languages, and the father says, study, let's say, medicine. The child wants to do languages, for example. Or the child wants to do media studies or journalism. The father says, no, medicine. Or, let's say, accountancy. There, if the child doesn't listen to the father, that won't be haram according to the Sharia. Because if they become disappointed, that's not something which is expected in this society. That's being disappointed for themselves. That won't be haram according to the Sharia. But then when you come to the tariqah, you have to be a slave to your parents. Especially the mother. But, I mean, no one can do that 100%. I'm just giving you ideas here. It's not wajib. But to be a slave to your mother. It's an important key to spiritual wayfaring. The tariqahs, there are many. It's not only one tariqah. Like the Sharia is one. The tariqah, there's many ways to God with the tariqah. With the Sharia, it's one way. The halals and the harams. With the tariqah, how many people are there? The same number of people there are tariqahs. There's one tariqah in Qom where it's based upon this principle. Be a slave to your parents. That's the way you grow, especially the mother. That's one tariqah. Allama Tabatabai has another way of tariqah. Imam Khomeini had another tariqah. But I'm saying with the tariqah now, it's more. It's spiritual growth here. Just one point with the university and subjects. this is just my opinion. I'm not saying this is 100%. No, not at all. I may be, most probably, I may be wrong. But if your children today become media specialists or go into journalism as a Muslim in this country, the benefits they can give to Islam internationally is 100 times more important, even to the Ummah, is 100 times more important than the benefit a doctor can do, or a, let's say, an engineer. Something is important for Islam. We have to go there. In England, it's happening. In America, they're very behind. I usually do tabligh in America. They never invite me. This, as I said, this was the second time. But in the last 4 years, I keep on going. They invite me there in America. In England, Islam is much more progressed. It's a very small country, you know, and they've managed to spread the message in a much more healthier way than in America, which is a very large country. Propagating there is very difficult. But what I tell them there, that if the youth there go into these specialities of journalism, media studies, the film industry, it can lead to a lot of positive results for the Ummah at large. Then, once upon a time, yes, it was doctors and engineers. But we have to have that balanced picture always. Okay. Anyway, Imam was saying, the inner impurities lead to the suppression of salvation. The inner impurities, the sins of the tariqah, not doing the noble ethical traits, the ethical sins, the inner impurities leads to the suppression of you acquiring salvation. It doesn't mean you're going to go to hell. This is not about, you know, who's going to go, who's not going to go. I want you to get the point here. Inner impurities leads to the suppression of salvation and constitutes the cause of ethical hell. Jahannam akhlaq. This is an incredible statement, this. These inner impurities, two things. They suppress your salvation, one. And it's these inner impurities, it's the cause to your ethical hell. Hell has degrees. Hell has degrees. This is one degree, one level. Then he says, and this ethical hell, which according to the people of Ma'rifah, this ethical hell is loftier and mightier and more burning than the hell of actions. Allahu Akbar, this. It's a very deep statement. And people have to be crying, shivering with statements like this. There's no room for complacency, whoever you think you are. These inner impurities, and they're not only one or two of them, there are a lot of them. They're very delicate. The wudu alone. Imam Khomeini, in this book, he says, according to the Urafa, they've numbered 150 dimensions to the wudu. It's all to do with the inner side of how the physical wudu helps you to get rid of those 150 inner impurities within. These inner impurities, they suppress your salvation. They're the cause of your ethical hell. They're the cause that will take you to ethical hell. The inner impurities. Not doing the noble ethical traits. Not doing the noble ethical traits will make you go to ethical hell. But we just suffice with the Sharia. It doesn't matter if you do all the wajibat and the muharramat. It's step one. But you can't suffice with step one. Because if you do step one, you do the Sharia completely, it means you won't have the hell of actions. You won't go in the hell of actions. But what about the ethical hell? What about the ethical hell? What are you going to do there? You just suffice with the Sharia, the halals and the harams all your life. You didn't even pay attention to those inner impurities which were outside the jurisdiction of the Sharia. They will lead you to go to the ethical hell. In heaven too, the same story exists. And then what's more interesting is that we have traditions where a mushrik, by the name of Hatam Ta'i, during the time of the Holy Prophet, he would do all the noble ethical traits. Yes. I'll just finish with this point. This was just an introduction to the hadith, but inshallah next time. Hatam Ta'i, he was a mushrik, but he would do all the noble ethical traits. Someone would do him wrong, he would forgive. He would never hold on to grudges. He was never jealous. He would keep on giving. He had the noble ethical traits, but he was a mushrik. So, the hell of actions he would deserve, but the ethical hell he won't have. The ethical hell was more burning, Imam said. And look how beautifully the traditions speak about Hatam Ta'i. Because it was a problem. Hatam was a problem for the people. For people like you, the complacent people, well, we do the wajibat, we don't do the sins. He's a mushrik. But people saw Hatam would do all the noble ethical traits. They asked the Holy Messenger, after the demise of Hatam, what's going to happen with him? Look how beautifully the traditions, which speaks to the common layperson. He says he's in hell, the hell of actions, because he didn't do those actions. But the fire of hell won't reach him. And he will be provided sustenance in his abode in hell. Oh, see, he escaped the ethical hell. And maybe he had the ethical heaven to some extent, the ethical heaven, not the heaven of actions. These are very important concepts. It takes time to digest a bit. And another tradition where a mushrik gave refuge to a Muslim in the land of the mushrik. And this applies to us here, to our parents, grandparents. They were given refuge here. There are some things in England, some traits that are very honorable. We have to, you know, speak very positively about some things. Some things are very negative. But anyway, he gave this refuge to the Muslim. Then after he passed away, he too was in hell because he was a mushrik. He rejected Islam. But then they spoke of his abode in hell. Fire wouldn't get to him. Although he's in hell, but fire won't reach him. The ethical hell didn't reach him. And he would be given sustenance in hell. Whilst many Muslims may burn in the fire in hell of actions. As Muslims, the equations differs. How you will be accounted for differs. There's no room for complacency. Okay, thank you for your time. Wa sallallahu ala Muhammad wa ala Ta'ala.